The next topic we're going to be going over today is hyperthyroidism. Now, what exactly is hyperthyroidism? Hyper means something is too much. From the what? From the thyroid gland. Very straightforward. What exactly is made in the thyroid gland? Thyroxine, right? The thyroid hormone. So, let's make the definition. What is the definition of hyperthyroidism? It's excessive amount of thyroid hormone, right? We are making more than we're supposed to, because it's a balance, right? If you're making too much, it's hyper. If you're making too low, it's hypothyroidism. Now, that is the definition. Too much T4, T3, right? Thyroid hormone. Now, that's abnormal. But exactly what can cause hyperthyroidism? What are the causes of hyperthyroidism? Now, the first and the most common cause of hyperthyroidism is Graves' disease. Another name for Graves' disease is diffuse thyrotoxicosis or toxic diffuse goiter. It's all these big fancy words, right? Toxic diffuse goiter. Now, what is goiter? Goiter is a fancy word for hyperplasia, huge thyroid. So, this is what somebody with Graves' disease thyroid is going to look like. It's going to be very, very huge. And the entire gland is actually hyper-functioning, which means that every single cell inside the gland is making too much thyroid hormone. Now, what is the cause of Graves' disease? It's an autoimmune process. Antibodies. There's a lot of antibodies that is binding too much antibodies. They're binding to receptors, right? Which are TSH receptors. So this would be an example of a TSH, which is thyroid stimulating hormone receptors, an immunoglobulin that binds to a TSH receptor is called they're called thyroid stimulating immunoglobulins, which are called TSIs. It makes sense. We have antibodies, right, that are actually binding to the TSH receptors, right? What are the TSH receptors normally respond to? They respond to the thyroid-stimulating hormone, but all of a sudden the antibodies are not being produced. They're not binding constantly. They're acting like TSH themselves. They're like, listen, make more, make more, make more. But the thyroid gland doesn't know that's not TSH, because he thinks it's the same TSH that's telling him to make a lot of T4 and T3s. So this guy's been fooled. Somebody else is taking his position of the TSH himself. So they call them thyroid stimulating immunoglobulins. They are what? What kind of molecules are they? They're IgGs. They're constantly binding and telling the thyroid gland to be cranking up a lot of thyroid hormones, causing you to become what? Hyperthyroid. So where did we come up with the word toxic diffuse goiter? Is because when you make it too much thyroid hormone, it's very toxic, because you cause a syndrome called thyrotoxicosis. Toxic amount of thyroid gland be made by the thyroid gland. So we call it hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxic syndrome, thyrotoxicosis, okay? Because the immunoglobulins are causing a lot of damages. Now, Now that we know what is causing it, and we know exactly what Graves' disease is, which is excessive amount of immunoglobulin that's binding to the thyroid gland, making it to crank up a lot of thyroid hormone, we also need to know that this disease has clinical features. And that's the next thing we're going to talk about. What are the clinical features of Graves' disease? But before we talk about what the clinical features of Graves' disease is, let's talk about another cause that can cause hyperthyroidism. So I want you to look at the structure that I'm drawing on this side of the table of the board. See, that is diffuse. The entire thyroid gland is cranking up immunoglobulin. What about if we just have just a little adenoma inside the thyroid gland that's just cranking up a lot of T4 and T3s? That is called what? Toxic nodular goiter or an adenoma. Now, in this case, you can see it's one little adenoma that's just cranking up a lot of thyroid hormone. Makes it completely different, right? See, it's just one little gland that's actually an adenoma that's cranking up a lot of thyroid gland, but it's causing you to also become what? Hyperthyroid. Now, that's called a hyperfunctioning adenoma or toxic nodular or toxic adenoma. You just call it a toxic adenoma or a hyperfunctioning adenoma. Now, those are the two ways you can become hyperthyroid. But what about drugs? Amiodarone. Our favorite drug, right? If you have a VTAC, right? We have to give you amiodarone in the hospital. Now, when you give patients amiodarone, it can actually cause you to become hyperthyroid, causing you to use up a lot of iodine to crank up a lot of what? Thyroid hormone, which can make you also hyperthyroid. Now, another way, since we can have one nodule, we can also have multiple nodules. Multiple nodules, just little pockets, apartments. Multiple nodules, it's like little houses, little factories inside your thyroid gland that's cranking up a lot of thyroid hormone, and that's called toxic multi-nodulus, multiple nodules and adenoma inside the thyroid gland, and that's called Plummer's disease. Now, in Plummer's disease, you have to know that these patients have an increased risk of developing CHF and arrhythmias. Why did I say they have an increased risk of developing CHF and arrhythmias? Is because we've talked about what the thyroid hormone does, right? Increase amount of what? Beta receptors in your heart, inside your body. Increased beta receptors means it's gonna be really responsive to sympathomimetic effects, causing you to contract a lot, increase contractility. Eventually, you can contract a lot to develop CHF. Also, you can develop arrhythmias because hyperthyroidism causes atrial fibrillation. That's a form of arrhythmia, irregular heart rhythm, which is not good. So, when you have toxic little nodules inside your thyroid, we call that toxic multinodular adenoma, which is Plummer's disease. Now that we've talked about all the different kinds of ways we can actually become hyperthyroid, let's go ahead and talk about the symptoms. We're gonna focus on Graves' disease or diffuse toxic thyrotoxicosis, right? Graves' disease. So what are the clinical manifestations? Let's talk about the symptoms. History and physical. The most amazing, the most features you're gonna see is exophthalmos and pre-tibial myxedema. Now, what are these two fancy words? When you look at the patient, let's kind of draw patient here. When you look at their eyes, it looks like this. See how wide their pupils are? It's kind of like almost bulging eyeballs. When they look at you, it looks like they're constantly staring at you. It's not like they're staring at you. It's because the antibodies that are actually causing them to develop hyperthyroidism that binds also deposits a lot of glycosaminoglycans on the, like the eyelids, and get them to get proptosis. So their eyes is really, really, really wide. And that's one of the symptoms you see. This is called exophthalmos. And they also develop pre-tibia myxedema. If you look at their tibia, let's say this is their leg, right? Right by the tibia bone in front, they develop a lot of edema right here. And when you push in, it gets an indentation. And that's one of the classic signs of hyperthyroidism. Now, they can get this also at the dorsum of their hands, okay? So that's very important. Now, let's talk about how we're gonna make the diagnosis. The two key features, we said exophthalmos, pre-tibial myxedema. However, they can develop all the symptoms, all the clinical findings you might find. They have lack of sleep, tremors. They develop a lot of tremors, like their hands are constantly shaking. They have frequent bowel movements, excessive sweating. Another symptoms you might see, they have a lot of palpitations, angina symptoms, weight loss. Despite they have good appetite, they're still losing weight. So they might, those are one of the symptoms you might see. The patient will tell the doc, I eat a lot of food, but still yet I'm losing weight. The eyes is very wide. You touch the tibia, you see like it's very edematous. It's getting like, I sweat a lot at night. This is because when you have too much T4s and T3s floating around your body, they increase your metabolic rate. And when your metabolic rate goes up, you start to get palpitations in your chest because beta 1 receptors are constantly being recruited, which is causing them to have a sympathomimetic effect on their heart. They can't sleep. They're sweating. They're shaking. Now, they also can develop osteoporosis because of the effect of thyroid gland on the bone. It stimulates osteoclasts to start to break down their bone, and they can actually develop osteoporosis. And when you break down bone, what do you develop also? Hypercalcemia, right? Because bone is made out of calcium. So we gotta make this diagnosis. This is extremely important because when these patients come in, they don't know what's wrong. So let's make the diagnosis. So what do we wanna order? The most important test we need to order is a TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. What do you think is going to happen to their TSH if they're cranking up so much T4s and T3s? There's a negative feedback. There's a negative feedback into the pituitary because the body thinks we're making so much thyroid hormone, we don't need TSH. But you know who's doing it? It's the thyroid stimulating immunoglobulins. So it's funny enough, their TSH will be very low. But what will happen to their T4s and T3s? It will be very, very high. However, another thing you might notice is that if you give them radioiodine, it's gonna uptake all the iodine and use it up, right? So the radioiodine uptake will be very high. Why? Because the gland is constantly making a lot of T4s and T3s. And T4s and T3s really need you, you need those iodine molecules. That's why your radioiodine uptake is always going to be elevated. But to actually find out that this is an autoimmune process, guess who we're going to look for? We have to look for those antibodies that's actually causing the problem. And guess what antibodies you're going to look for? The antimicrosomal antibodies. That's the first one you want to order for. And the antithyroglobulin antibodies. Remember, thyroglobulin is that little protein that has tyrosine on it that takes that iodine that actually binds it to form an MIT, organification reaction. So those antibodies are constantly stimulating that guy. You're going to be able to detect it if you order this two tests and you order a TSH. But TSH is so important because it tells you whether something is going on here or here. It's a primary hyperthyroidism, which is mean at the level of the gland, this is primary. If it's going up in the pituitary, that becomes a secondary. So when I mean a secondary hyperthyroidism, that means, let's assume there's a little adenoma producing a lot of TSH, which is very, very rare. And cranking up a lot of T4 and T3s in this situation, that's completely different. Now that we've made the diagnosis, we're gonna have to learn how to treat this patient. How do we treat the patient? Low TSH, right? Let's treat the patient. Treatment. So, this is an autoimmune process that's going on, right? This is, and we have hyperthyroidism. What can we give this patient to make them feel better? We can go into the thyroid gland and give them a hormone that's gonna block the synthesis of thyroid hormone. And guess which drug we're going to use? Propylthiouracil. Or we can use methimazole. Now these guys are gonna, they actually inhibit coupling and organification of T4 and T3 molecules. And by inhibiting what? The enzyme iodide peroxidase. Now, if you don't know where this enzyme is coming from, you have to go back and watch a basic physiology of the thyroid gland so you can see what coupling and organification means. However, because every drug has a side effect, we are blocking the synthesis inside the thyroid gland, right? So that even if the antibodies are telling them to make more, we don't have the basic product to form coupling and organification to make a T4 and a T3 thyroid hormone. However, there's adverse drug reactions which you got to look out for, which is a skin rash and agranulocytosis, which means lack of white blood cells or really, really low white blood cell count. So when you put patients on propylthiouracil or methimazole, always check their white count, because if they mount a fever, they cannot, I repeat, they will not be able to mount an immune response, and these people can die. It's very crucial. Always keep an eye on their white count or their CBC if they ever develop a fever. Now, which of these two medications is safe during pregnancy? Pregnancy. Let's see. Pregnancy starts with a P. So which of the drugs start with a P? Propylthiouracil, right? So propylthiouracil is the only drug that is safe to use in pregnancy. They will ask you on your boards one of these days and you will be shocked. Now, we can always give these patients control their adrenergic symptoms, right? Because why are they having the tremors? It's not because they're just hyperthyroid, it's because of the adrenergic side effects, the beta 1 receptor synthesis, right? So they're having palpitations because they're having too much sympathomimetic effect. So this is how I remember hyperthyroidism. since it's hyper, if you ever see somebody all over the place, yeah, that's kind of hyper, but kind of hyper in a way of thinking like this. In my heart, I'm going to get a lot of palpitations. I'm going to be shaking, a lot of tremors. I'm kind of nervous. If I'm nervous, I can't sleep. That's why the side effect is so bad. They can't sleep, right? They can't really concentrate. They start to lose weight because their basal metabolic rate is so super, super high. They're losing a lot of weight despite eating a lot of good food. So how do we block these bitter receptors? We use a bitter blocker. So you can give them propranolol. And propranolol, it's a bitter blocker. It's good because now we can block all those little bitter one receptors all over the place, right? That's being stimulated all the time to control the tremors, right? The sweating, so those adrenergic symptoms, the palpitations, the angina symptoms these patients are having. Now, this is just medications, but if somebody actually has an overfunctioning thyroid gland, right? We can do a radio ablation therapy. Radio means radioactive, right? Radioactive. So we're gonna be using an isotope, an iodine molecule, radio ablation therapy. And we actually use iodine-131, right? And this is actually a destructive molecule. And remember I told you that gland is pretty hyperfunctioning. If it's diffused, like Graves' disease, if you give them iodine-131, it actually destroys the tissue. Because it's a radioisotope. They try to metabolize it, it destroys the tissue. If they have just a single nodule, right? Because this tissue is very hyperfunctioning, it's gonna try to reuptake, sucking all that iodine, right? It's getting excited, but the bad news is, it's not gonna make it anymore. It's gonna shrink, and it's gonna die. That's radioablation therapy. Now, the last but not the least, if that doesn't work, you're gonna have to take it out. So to call the surgeon, we're gonna have to take out your thyroid gland. But if I take out your thyroid gland, what do you think is gonna happen? Well, you don't have any more thyroid gland, you can't make any more thyroid hormone. Now you're gonna be what? Hypothyroid. And if you don't have any thyroid hormone, the only thing I have to do is give you back what I took away. So you now have to put you on levothyroxine, which we're gonna give you because now iatrogenically, which means I did it, well, I'm not a surgeon, but the surgeon did it, levothyroxine or L-thyroxine, we give you the drug that you normally your body's supposed to make so that we replace it back. And that is the end of our lecture on hyperthyroidism. Very straightforward, guys, right? We talked about what it is, too much T4s and T3s. I'm a thyroid hormone. The TSH is going to be low because of the negative feedback. These people have a lot of palpitations. They develop atrial fibrillation. Remember that. It's extremely important. Arrhythmias, right? An autoimmune process, Graves' disease. But Graves' disease, I want you to also remember that these patients, because they are making autoantibodies, like self-made antibodies against their thyroid, don't you think they're gonna be making it against other things like systemic autoimmune diseases like what? Myasthenia gravis, antibodies against the muscles, right? They're gonna be making antibodies also to in pernicious anemia against intrinsic factor. So it become pernicious and they develop pernicious anemia. These patients can develop other autoimmune diseases. So not just Graves' disease. Because once you develop one, it's a catastrophic disaster for another. To wrap it up, you can also have just one little nodule. We call that toxic nodular goiter. Just cranking up a lot of thyroid hormone. You can also have a take being an amiodarone, which can cause thyrotoxicosis. So you want to keep an eye on the TSH levels when they're on these medications. We diagnose it by ordering a TSH. We give you some radioiodine therapy. If it takes it up very high, you know it's hyperthyroid gland. Your TSH is going to be low. The T4 and T3 are going to be very, very high. We treat you by giving you methimazole, appropriate thiouracil. those are medications that we got to keep an eye out for, a granulocytosis. On the flip side of things, we can give you a radioablation therapy and give you a radioisotope that's going to destroy the gland, or go in and take it out. And that's the end of our lecture on hyperthyroidism. The next lecture we're going to be going over is not going to be what happens when you don't have the thyroid gland at all, which is hypothyroidism. Thank you very much for watching this video. Have a great day. Bye-bye.